Welcome to e lecture series for BTech 6M subject artificial intelligence. Myself Prakash Mina, assistant professor computer science and engineering college Ajmer. So last topic is our learning decision trees, and we have covered some these topics. So we'll go to our today's topic here, choosing attribute test. So greedy search used in decision tree learning is designed to approximately minimize the depth of the final tree, and the idea is to pick the attribute that goes as far as possible towards providing an exact classification of the example. And a perfect attribute divides the example into sets, each of which are all positive or all negatives, and thus will be leaves of the tree. The patron attribute is not perfect, but it is fairly good. A really useless attribute such as type leaves the example sets with roughly the same proportion of positive and negative examples as the original set. And all we need is a formal measure of fairly good and really useless, and we can implement the importance functions like figure. I think here, okay, figure here, like this algorithm, and we will use the notion of the notion of information gain, which is defined in terms of entropy, and the fundamental quantity is in information theory. So entropy is a measure of the uncertainty of a random variable. Acquisitions of information correspond to a reduction in entropy. A random variable with only one value, a coin that always comes up heads, has no uncertainty, and thus its entropy is defined as zero. Thus we gain no information by observing its value. A flip of a fair coin is equally likely to come up heads or tails, zero or one, and we will see that this counts as one bit of entropy. And the role of a fair four-sided die has two bits of entropy, because it takes two bits to describe one or one of four equally probable choices. And now consider an unfair coin that comes up heads 99% of the time. And intuitively, this coin has been uncertainty than the fair coin. If we guess heads, we will be wrong only 1% of the time. So we would like it to have an entropy measure that is close to zero, and but positive. So the entropy of a random variable v with value vk, each with probability vk, is defined as entropy. Here you can see in slide. So HV is equal to summation of probability VK log 2 1 by divided by probability of VK is equal to minus summation P probability of VK into log 2 probability of VK. So we can check that the entropy of a fair coin flip is needed 1 bit, and here H fair is equal to you can say is equal to 1 after calculation. And if the coin is loaded to give 99% head, we get H loaded is equal to minus. So calculations similar to 0.008 bits. And if we'll have to define BQ as the entropy of a boolean random variable that is true with probability Q, so here BQ is equal to minus Q log 2 Q plus 1 minus Q log 2 1 minus Q, and thus head H for head loaded is equal to B for boolean random is equal to 0.99 is equal to 0.08. Now let's get back to decision tree learning. So if a training set contains p positive examples and n negative examples, then the entropy of the goal attributes on the whole set is h goal is equal to h boolean, where a random variable, so p divided by p plus n, and the restaurant training set in figure here you can see, okay, here. So hp is equal to n is equal to 6, so the corresponding entropy is boolean b for 0.5 or exactly 1 bit, and a test on a single attributes a might give us only one only part of this 1 bit. So we can measure exactly how much by looking at the entropy remaining after the attribute test. So here you can see the h goal, an attribute a with d distinct value divide the training set e into subsets e1 to ed. Each subset ek has pk positive examples and nk negative examples. So if we get we go along the branch, we will need an additional b for boolean random variable, and b into pk divided by pk plus nk bits of information to answer the questions. So a randomly chosen example from the training set has the kth value for the attribute with probability pk plus nk divided by p plus n. So the expected entropy remaining after testing attribute a is, here you can say remainder a, you can see here, and summation of pk plus nk divided by p plus n and boolean. So pk divided by pk plus nk, and there is the k one from 1 to d, and the information gain. So information gain from the attribute test on a is the expected reduction in entropy. So here gain a is equal to b for boolean p divided by p plus n minus remainder a, and goal gain a is just what we need to implement the importance function, and returning to the attributes considers in figure here you can see 4. Okay, so in figure here we have gain patron and gain type. So we have written here yes, gain patron you can say after calculation equal to 0.541 bits, or gain type is point is equal to 0 bits. So confirming our intuitions that patron is a better attribute to split on. In fact, patron has the maximum gain of any of the attributes and would be chosen by the decision tree learning algorithm as the root. Okay, that's about information gain, and now generalization and overfitting. So on some problem, the decision tree learning algorithm will generate a large tree when there is a actually no pattern to be found. So consider the problem of trying to predict whether the role of a die will come up as 6 or not, and suppose that experiments are carried out with various dice that the attribute describing each training example includes the color of the die, its weight, the time when the role was done, and whether the experiment had their fingers crossed. So if the dice are fair, the right things to learn is a tree with a single node that says no. But the decision tree learning algorithm will says on any patterns it can find in the input, and if it turns out that there are two rows of a 7 gram blue die with fingers crossed and they both come out 6, then the algorithm may construct a path that predicts 6 in that case. So this problem is called as overfitting, and a general phenomenon, overfitting occurs with all types of learner, and even when the target function is not at all random. So in figure 1, okay, if we have figure 1, I think we have a we have not included here a figure. So you can see in the reference book, We missed that figure here. Okay, so one more thing, so anyway we can, because it's continuous. Okay, here we will get the figure. Okay, this is the figure. So here you figure B and B figure C, we saw polynomial functions overfitting the data, and overfitting becomes more likely as the hypothesis space and the number of input attribute grows, and less likely as we increase the number of training examples. So okay, now we will go to our topic. Okay, now for decision tree, a technique called decision tree pruning combats overfitting. Pruning works by eliminating nodes that are not clearly relevant, and we start with a full tree as generated by decision tree learning, and we then took a test node that has only leaf node as descendants, and if the test appears to be irrelevant, detecting only noise in the data, then we eliminate the test and replacing it with a leaf node, and we repeat this process considering each test with only leaf descendants and until each one has either been pruned or accepted as is. So here is a question: how do we detect that a node is testing an irrelevant attribute? And suppose for this, suppose we are at a node consisting of p positive and n negative examples. If the attribute is irrelevant, we would expect that it would split the examples into subsets that each have roughly the same proportion of positive examples as the whole set, and p divided by p plus n, and so the information gain will be close to zero, and thus the information gain is good clue to irrelevance. Now the again a question: how large a gain should we require in order to split on a particular attribute? So here we can answer this question by using a statistical significant test. Such a test begin by assuming that there is no underlying patterns and so called null hypothesis. Okay, here, so then the actual data are analyzed to calculate the extent to which they deviate from a perfect absence of pattern, and if the degree of deviation is statistically unlikely, then that is considered to be good evidence for the presence of a significant pattern in the data, and the probabilities are calculated from standard distributions of the amount of deviation one would expect to see in random sampling. So here in case the null hypothesis is that the attribute is irrelevant, and hence that the information gain for an infinitely large sample would be zero, and we need to calculate the probability under the null hypothesis. A sample of size v is equal to n plus p would exhibit the observed deviation from the expected distribution of a positive and negative examples. So we can measure the deviation by comparing the actual numbers of positive and negative examples in each subset pk and nk, and with expected numbers cap pk and cap nk, assuming two irrelevance. So here cap pk is equal to p into pk plus nk divided by p plus n, and cap nk is equal to n into pk plus nk divided by p plus n. So a convenient measure of the total deviation is given by here delta, so is equal to summation pk minus cap pk square and divided by cap pk plus nk minus cap nk square divided by cap nk, where k is equal to 1 to d, and under the null hypothesis the value of delta is distributed according to the x square, or you can see chi square distribution with v minus 1 degree of freedom, and we can use chi square table or a standard statistical library routine to see if a particular delta value confirms or rejects the null hypothesis. And here is an example: consider the restaurant type attributes. Already we have seen the four with four values, and thus 3 degrees of freedom, a value of delta is equal to 7.82, or mode would reject the null hypothesis at the 5% level. And decision tree algorithm, learning algorithm, is to implement this form of pruning, which is known as chi square pruning. So with pruning, noise in the examples can be tolerated, errors in the examples, labels examples labels have an asymptotic effect that gets worse as the tree shrinks down to smaller sets, and pruned tree performs significantly better than unpruned trees when the data contains a large amount of noise. Now also, the pruned tree are often much smaller and hence easier to understand. So there is one more thing. So the chi square pruning and information gain look similar, so why not combine them using an approach called early stopping. So early stopping have the decision tree algorithm stop generating nodes when there is no good attributes to split on, and rather than going to all the trouble of generating nodes and then pruning them away. So the problem with early stopping is that it stops us from recognizing situations where there is no one good attributes, but there are a combination of attributes that are informative. And for example, consider the XOR function of two binary attributes. If there are roughly equal number of examples for all four combination of input values, then the neither attributes will be informative, yet the correct thing to do is to split on one of the attributes. So and then at the second level we will get split that are informative, and early stopping would miss this, but generate and then prune handles it correctly. So that's all about early stopping here. And now our next topic is broadening the applicability of decision tree. So here are some points you can see here. Only we will discuss these points here. So in order to extend decision tree induction to a wide variety of problems, a number of issues must be addressed, and we will briefly mention several, suggesting that a full understanding is best obtained by doing some associated exercise. So first, data. In many domains, not all the attributes value will be known for every examples. The value might have gone unrecorded, or they might be too expensive to obtain. This gives rise to two problems. First, given a complete decision tree, and second, how should one modify the information gain formula when some examples have unknown values for the attributes. So these are the questions addressed for missing data. And multi-valued attributes, when an attribute has many possible values, the information gain measures give an appropriate indication of the attribute's usefulness. In the extreme case, an attribute such as exact time has a different value for every example, and which means each subset of examples is a singleton with a unique classification, and the information gain measures how would have in its highest value for these attributes. But choosing this split in first is unlikely to yield the best tree. So one solution is to use the gain ratio, and another possibility is to allow a Boolean test of the form A is equal to VK that is picking out just one of the possible values for an attributes, leaving the remaining value to possibly be tested later in the tree. Then next, continuous and integer valued input attributes. So continuous or integer valued attributes such as height and weight have an infinite set of possible values, and rather than generate infinitely many branches, decision tree learning algorithm typically find split point that gives the highest information gain. And here example, at a given node in the tree, it might be the case that testing on weight greater than 160 gives the most information. An efficient method exists for finding good split points, start by sorting the values of the attributes and then consider only one only split points that are between two examples in the sorted order that have different classifications. And while keeping track of the running totals of positive and negative examples on each side of the split point. So splitting is the most expensive part of real world decision tree learning application. And next, continuous valued output attributes. If we are trying to predict a numerical output value such as the price of an apartment, then we need to regression tree rather than a classification tree. And regression tree has at each leaf a linear function of some subset of numerical attributes rather than a single value. So here example, the branch for two bedroom apartment might end with a linear function of square footage, number of bathrooms and average income for the neighborhood. And the learning algorithm must decide when to stop splitting and begin applying linear regression over the attributes. So decision tree learning system for real world application must be able to handle all these type of problems, and handling continuous value variables is especially important because both physical and financial processes provide numerical data. And several commercial packages have been built that meet these criteria, and they have been used to develop thousands of fielded systems. And in many areas of industry and commerce, decision tree are usually the first method tried when a classification method is to be extracted from a data set. One important property of decision tree is that it is possible for a human to understand the reason for the output of the learning algorithm. So that's all about for decision tree. So here we completed the decision tree topic. So session ends here. Thank you.